The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Welcome to the CSE webinar on INDCs of the United States, whether they are fair and equitable. Our speakers for today are Sunita Narayan and Chandrabhushan. They are going to be with you in a little while. Please stay online and please stay connected. If there's an echo on your machine or on your headset, please use a pair of headphones. Thank you.
Chandrabhushan and I, I'm Sunita Narayan, and we will take you through the key findings of our report, which we are releasing now. We have called the report Capitan America. It's a report which looks at the United States Climate Action Plan and takes a very serious, careful look to understand, is the U.S. the world's largest historical polluter? Is it actually changing the way it is doing its business? Is it actually reducing emissions? And we do this because we very seriously believe that the world needs an effective and an ambitious climate agreement. So the first thing for us, and we come as we are from South Asia, we strongly believe that there is a need for climate action to be urgent, because in South Asia we are seeing what weather changes can do. They're leading to huge amount of losses for farmers, and we call this our seasons of despair. And so we believe that the world needs an effective agreement at Paris to combat climate change. We have looked at the U.S. because the U.S. is the world's largest historical polluter, second largest emitter annually, has a very high per capita CO2, and after years of climate denial, it has signaled that it is ready to take action. More important, it is also said that even if its INDC, which is its target, is not ambitious, it will put the U.S. on track for long-term emission reductions. So the question we are asking is this really the case? Does it herald new hope in the world? Will it build a new cooperative climate agreement in Paris? And if not, then what we believe is that this would be really bad news. Go through some of the key findings that we have. in the report.
Well, what we have done is that we have gone to each and the most important sectors of US economy and to analyze whether there are real changes happening in reducing the emissions of those sectors or not. But before we do that, we would like to analyze and give you our assessment of US INDC. As you know, that US has submitted its INDCs a few months back and has committed to reduce emissions by 26 to 28% below 2005 levels by 2025. And it has stated that its targets is fair and ambitious. Now, if you look at the history of climate commitment of the US, of course, US walked out of the Kyoto Protocol. The first time US made any commitment was in 2010 in Cancun, where US actually came out with a roadmap for emission reduction, under which it said that it will reduce emissions by 17% below 2005 levels by 2020, 30% by 2025, and 42% by 2030. Now, if you look at the INDC that US has submitted now, then from 30% commitment in Cancun in 2010, it has reduced its commitment to 26 to 28% now in 2015. And therefore, US ambition on reducing emissions has actually has got lowered than the weak Cancun pledge of 2010. And therefore, in 5 years, the US has not ratcheted up its ambition, rather than it has reduced it. And this puts a big question mark on Paris Agreement, where the whole agreement is based on the premise that the countries will ratchet up their ambition of reducing emissions, finance and technology over the period of time. Now, the one way to look at US INDC is to look at ambition of US and compare it to other developed countries, and we have done that by comparing it to Europe. Now, if you take 1990 as baseline, you find that US will cut its emission by 13 to 15% by 2025 and 23 to 27% by 2030. Because US has put baseline of 2005, it is talking about 26 to 28% by 2025 from 2005 baseline. From 1990 baseline, the emission cuts in the US by 2025 will be marginal. Now, compared to EU, which is planning to reduce it by 40% by 2030 from 1999, 23 to 27% by 2030 in the US actually is very modest. It is not only about percentage reduction, also in terms of absolute emission cut, US will cut its emissions by about 1.5 billion tons of CO2 by 2030. Whereas EU will cut by about 2.25 billion tons in 2030. In terms of per capita also, in 2030, US emission will be about 12.5 tons per capita, whereas EU's will be 6.5 tons. So the US INDC is not ambitious, and it is also not equitable. If you look at how much carbon space US is going to occupy from now till 2025. Now, we all, you will remember that IPCC has come out with a carbon budget of 2,900 billion tons of carbon dioxide emissions from 1850 to 2100 to keep the world below 2 degrees temperature rise. Now, the world has already emitted from 1850 to 2011 about 1900 billion tons of CO2, and therefore the world remains with about 1000 billion tons of CO2 budget from 2012 to 2100. Now, looking at this budget, we find that US has already appropriated huge amount of budget so far, 411 billion tons since 1850 to 2011. US INDC of 26% reduction by 2025 actually means that US is going to appropriate another 80 billion tons by 2025. And therefore, from 1850 to 2025, with 5% of the world population, US is going to appropriate 17% of the carbon space, which is certainly not equitable. So its INDC is not fair, and its INDC is not equitable. Now, So the next question that is important to ask is, yes, its INDC is not ambitious. Beginning to reduce its emission, has it put policy in place which is which will move into low carbon? Now this we have answered by analyzing all important sectors, and our conclusion is very clear. Our analysis shows that US climate change action plan in all the sectors are business as usual, and that US policies are not moving its economy to low carbon growth.
So what we have done is now to look at the different sectors, and the first sector, which we will give you our idea of our analysis, is the clean power plant program of the US. And essentially what we have done is to look at the Obama plan, and we have tried to understand what does it mean in terms of reductions. And what comes out is that the clean power plant of plan of the US is actually nothing more than business as usual. There is a switch from coal to natural gas, but it is happening because it is cheaper to produce and consume natural gas today than coal. So it is happening because of market forces, it is happening automatically, and in fact our analysis shows, and we will urge you to download the report and our detailed presentation from the website, you will see that in fact the Obama Clean Power Plan is even less ambitious than what would have happened automatically because of the market, which is driving the US towards clean, a cleaner natural gas. But what also comes out is that the country will consume more energy and not less by 2030, and emission reduction in this scenario is therefore predicated on how clean is the natural gas, which is the switch that it is making. And if recent evidence which suggests that there could be higher methane emissions in natural gas production, then you actually may be in a worse situation because you have increased the use of energy by 2030, and that clean energy which you thought was cleaner is actually not so clean. What it is also showing is that there is a complete delay. In fact, the move to natural gas means the US will not make a transition to renewable energy. And in 2030, the US will remain fossil fuel addicted, it will have cheap energy, and so unabated emissions. We have also looked at transport, we have looked at the building sector, and again, we would urge you to go to our website and to download both the presentation as well as our detailed report. But the conclusion of our report of the INDC that we have, the review that we have made, is the following. CB?
Now, both in building sector and transport sector, US entire action is based on improving efficiency in building sector and in transport sector. For example, it has set energy fuel efficiency standards for vehicles, appliances, and has a voluntary standard on energy efficiency in buildings. Now, our analysis very clearly shows that these efficiency standards are not working, simply because as buildings become more efficient, as appliances become more efficient, as cars are becoming more efficient, Americans are consuming more and more. They are buying more cars, they are building bigger houses, and they are using more and more appliances. And therefore, efficiency gains are not getting converted into real and hard emission cuts, simply because the lifestyle is not changing in the US. US people are buying more cars, they are driving more because now driving has become cheaper because vehicles are more efficient, they are building bigger houses, and they are buying more appliances. And therefore the silver bullet which the US has put out to solve its emissions problem in transport and building sector is actually not working.
The same thing we did was we also looked at the industrial sector. Now, industry, you have to remember, is the one sector in the US where you actually see a decrease in emissions from 1990 onwards. And the question we were asking is, how has the US achieved this decrease? Has it actually made changes in technology, in its cement industry, in its iron and steel industry, in the way it manufactures goods? And we found that actually US industry remains behind Europe as well as Japan when it comes to many processes which will improve efficiency of manufacturing. So the question for us still was, what have they done? How has the emissions in the industrial sector reduced to such an extent when we are seeing no real structural changes in the economy? And what comes out is a fascinating truth that the personal consumption expense on goods have actually doubled from 1990. But what the US is doing is to buy more imported goods. So if you look at this table, it shows very clearly that personal consumption expenditure on all goods has increased, but total import of all goods has also increased. So it suggests very clearly that the US has not reduced its emissions, it has actually outsourced its emissions. And this chart, which looks at what is it importing, shows clearly that it is importing goods which are energy intensive, and therefore it is China or other countries where those emissions are now arising. So in industry, the only sector where emissions are below 1990 levels, the question for us is if these emissions are low because of changes in the way of production or because the US has outsourced production. And our analysis shows that consumption of goods has increased, imports have increased, and so they have outsourced and there is no gain for climate.
And therefore, the analysis of all the key sectors, and we have also analyzed agriculture sector, and you can have a look about the kind of wastage that happens in food production system in the US. But our overall conclusion is that in the US there is no evidence of a policy driven downward trend in GHG emissions post 2005, which according to US is the year when its emissions peaked. In fact, our analysis is that as the economy is picking up, so is consumption and consequently emissions.
Now the two things that we will not get into detail here, but our analysis shows very clearly that the reason this is happening is because the US is actually consuming more, and therefore what we are saying is that the climate change, combating climate change has to be linked with consumption. If you look at this chart, we call the US the Malthusians, because in all data is showing that the household consumption expenditure of the US is double that of the Europeans and 44 times that of Indians. Or if you were to compare it to Bangladeshis, Australians, Chinese, Japan, Mexico, Nigeria, Poland, in each case, rich or poor country, the US per capita household expenditure is huge, and in fact, I would say out of whack. The other thing that comes out very clearly is that the cost of energy in the US remains low. In fact, the cost of energy it remains the one thing in which you have a per capita electricity has gone up, the cost of energy has gone up. When it goes up, consumption comes down, but when it comes down, consumption also comes down. And what we know, and we have the data, is that actually the energy country in the world where energy is actually cheaper today than it was in 1990. Now, the we say very clearly it is not ambitious. Policies are business as usual. But what does it mean for the world?
Now, the first implication is that as US is not doing anything, the burden of climate change is shifting to other countries. And we have explained this through renewable energy, where it is quite clear that the world burden of shifting to renewable energy is on China and Europe now. In 2014, less than 15% of global investment in renewable energy happened in US compared to 31% in China and 21% in Europe. In fact, even a poor country like India now spends more on renewable energy than the US. India invested in 2014 0.3% of its GDP on renewables, US invested 0.2%. In fact, our analysis now very clearly shows that US is moving to renewable when it is cheap, whereas the rest of the world is moving to renewable when it is expensive. So for example, the cheapest source of electricity in the US is wind and natural gas. And therefore, US is moving to natural gas in big way as well as increasing wind. But US is not moving to solar simply because solar is expensive. It is countries like China, European countries and India and parts of Africa where solar is becoming big even when it is expensive, but it is not happening in the US. So US is shifting the burden of transition to other countries.
The second implication is that actually the US is bringing down the ambition of all countries. Now if you know this, all of us who've been watching climate change debates, this is not new. The fact is every time it is the US reluctance to do something about climate change that the world has revised its target and gone backwards. And the US today, what is happening is that every country is pegging its own INDC to the US, and this is a race to the bottom. Because the US making it clear that it will do nothing means that other countries then have to ask also for their equal space to the atmosphere, and that means that it just does not work for the planet. And this is related to implication three, which is that actually climate is about consumption. And everybody, I know every Indian, and I'm sure everybody in the world wants to either be an American or live like an American, because that's the aspirational role model that we have in the world. Now, if the world cannot afford the lifestyle of one US, how can it afford the lifestyle of many? And so we need the US to make sure it changes its way of consumption, lead by example, because otherwise climate negotiations will just not be useful or ambitious.
And that brings us to the issue of climate negotiations and Paris.
Okay, so I mean this was actually at the end, if it's hanging it's not such a problem. But essentially the point we are making is that in Paris, what will be the directions that the countries will take? Will they agree to go with the American way? Less and less action towards less ambition, made sure it's very divisive, very obstructive, and has created a framework which actually is so meaningless today because it is bottom-up and voluntary. Or will in Paris the world sit back and say, no, we will make a climate deal which actually suits the poorest in the world and the most affected, and we will not do a climate deal which suits the interests of a polluter which refuses to change its ways.
So finally, our conclusion is that US is not doing more. In fact, it needs to do many more times than what it is doing. It needs to put policy in place which is credible, which is effective, which will lead to real cuts. Much more it has to do if it really wants to say that it is not business as usual. Right now, everything that is happening in the US, according to our analysis, is business as usual. We look forward to people who can explain this in any other way than what our analysis shows. We need much more action from US, we need more ambition from US, we need effective reduction in emissions, we need real and measurable changes, which is not happening. We believe that if US doesn't act, it is going to have huge implications for global climate deal. Climate change is real. Its impacts are already affecting the poor of the world in Africa, Asia, and other parts of the world. And therefore, we need US to act. It cannot hide behind its excuse of economy and consumption not to do more on climate change. It is important that it takes action for all of us, for the world, to have a credible climate action plan.
Thank you. I think that's the end of our presentation, but please download the book from our website. The full presentation is also available for you to see. And we look forward now to your questions and issues that you would like to raise.
Am I on? Thank you, Sunita ji and Chandrabhushan. We have a few questions to begin with. The first of these have come from Ranjan Kumar Amritnidhi, who is a journalist based in Patna. And he is asking, US is the greatest polluter. Are there any environmental laws to remind it that it needs to control its carbon footprints? Shall I repeat the question?
No, we've got the question, and I think it's a very, very good question. And I think this is really at the core of the climate debate. The fact is, there are no laws. There was a law. The world attempted to bring a law under the Kyoto Protocol. It was the first and the only legally binding protocol under which the world was committed to reduce its emissions. And it was also agreed in Kyoto that there would be a compliance mechanism which would force countries to adhere to the commitment that they had made. But first, the US worked very hard to weaken the Kyoto Protocol. It then worked very hard to weaken the compliance mechanism and then walked out of Kyoto. So it essentially made sure that the world was left with a loophole-ridden instrument which was weak in compliance and could never really make effective change. And worse, it made sure that it was not part of it, because it said its Congress cannot become below any global instrument, which is why today the world has moved towards a voluntary system because of the US pressure, because the US says that its Congress is supreme and cannot be under the legal obligation that is set by any other country of the world. So Ranjan, very good question, and this, to my mind, is the biggest reason why the world is struggling today to find how to control the emissions of the world's largest polluter. But what is very clear is that if the world does not have a way to control the most powerful, the richest, it will only make sure that the burden of transition is on the poorest.
Thank you, Sunita ji. There's another question which is coming in. I can't make out who the journalist is, but he's asking that he or she, that how has the Indian government reacted to this report that was released today? Because the news has also got out, I think, that you have been there to meet the minister as well. So would you like to respond to that?
Yes, we went to the minister. We have handed over the report to the environment minister and his colleagues at the ministry. I will not talk about his reactions, but obviously we have stressed the point that it is important for Government of India to take the message of this book to every place, because the message is important even if it is inconvenient. It is important that Government of India understands the gravity of non-action in the US, because at the end of the day, countries like India will suffer because US is not taking action. And therefore, we have stressed and we have requested the minister that he should talk about consumption issues, talk about credible action in developed countries, talk about credible deal and effective deal for the poor of the world at Paris.
Superno?
Yeah, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Yeah, thanks,
yes.
Bhushan. Third question coming in 1992, George Bush Sr. said that American lifestyle is not negotiable. Are you suggesting that the ethic or belief still underpins the US approach to climate action?
Absolutely. We are saying loudly and clearly that what George Bush said in 1992, that the US lifestyle is non-negotiable, has been taken to heart by every American. That actually, if you look at it, their consumption is increasing and continues to increase. It's out of whack, as I keep saying. It's their houses are becoming bigger, their cars are guzzling more, they are driving more, buying more, more appliances. So consumption is not even linked to climate. But what I want to add is the fact that what is sad is that US NGOs are not raising issues of consumption either. So US environmental NGOs, largely big ones based in Washington, are not also raising the issue of consumption when it comes to climate change. They never talk about the fact that US needs car restraint on the number of cars. They will talk about it as a solution for China or India, but not as a solution for Washington, D.C. So it is very clear that consumption is a C word which adds up to climate change. And it is also very clear that we have to make the U.S. lifestyle and consumption negotiable.
Thank you. Subhano? Yeah, thank you, Sunita ji. Another question coming in. So do you expect this study, the report that has come out today, I presume that's referring to that, to influence thinking and action in the developing world?
I think the report is targeted to everyone, especially to the developed world, because we believe that developed world needs to take credible and quick action right now. But we also believe that the message of this book, which is that we can't go the American way, is valid for developing world as well. But I think the first target, we are going to Paris, I think our emphasis is that developed world takes the message, this is a hard and inconvenient message that we are giving, that they will have to change fast. People have been talking about it since 1990. I think it is high time that this message is taken and internalized in their economy and politics. But developing countries also need to make sure that we don't grow and pollute as they have done, because we will not have a space to clean up later on. So I think the message is important for developing countries, but right now this message is for developed countries that they need to change and change quickly.
But it's also, if I can add, CB, to this, I also think it's very important for our developing country governments to take to Paris a very clear message. And that is what comes out of this report, that our governments must make it very clear that we want an effective deal, we want an ambitious deal. Climate change impacts are here, we can feel it, we are suffering because of it. And our government must say that we also want an equitable deal, which means that the US must become more ambitious so that it can vacate carbon space. Today, the US is appropriating disproportionately carbon space. And its lack of ambition means that it will continue to appropriate more carbon space, which Africa needs, which India needs. So by 2030, as we showed you, the United States would have appropriated 17% of the total global carbon budget. And if you take the US and the other key polluters, then almost the entire carbon budget is over by 2030. Now that is unacceptable, because countries like India and large numbers of countries in Africa need space to grow. So this is the message for the developing country governments to take to Paris. Thanks, Shupano.
Thank you, Sunita ji. There is one final question which I can see coming in. Common sense suggests that natural gas is a cleaner fuel. Cleaner in apostrophe S. So isn't the switch in the US a good one?
I think you must understand why the switch has happened. The switch has happened because US has found a very polluting way to produce more natural gas, and that is shale formation, shale gas. And which is that it is going to produce gas very cheaply, but it is an extremely polluting process. But most importantly, it is not as clean as people are claiming, because there is large emissions of methane from shale gas production wells. Now, we all know that methane is a much more potent greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide. In fact, there is an estimation by International Energy Agency that if gas wells in the US lose 3% of methane, just 3% of methane from production to consumption, then natural gas is actually more climate polluting than even coal. So I think in theory, yes, natural gas is cleaner, but only when loss of methane is not there. If we are able to capture all the methane and burn all the methane, then the natural gas has lower carbon emission intensity than coal. But if there is even minute release of natural gas, say 3%, then its advantage over coal is gone. Now the problem in the US is that their data on methane emissions are very, very poor, and therefore we believe and our analysis shows that US actually is underestimating methane emissions from oil and gas sector. So in theory, yes, but in practice, we have doubts that a large use of natural gas is actually good for climate.
Thanks, Chandrabhushan. There is another question, I'm sorry, which has come in. Why is the US INDC silent on finance and tech transfer, specifically with reference to India's INDC, clearly talking about the transition cost? Would you care to comment?
I think it's a very good question, and it's actually the most appropriate question. The fact is the US has worked very hard and very aggressively to both make sure that the INDC framework is that all countries have to act, and therefore it wants to erase the difference between the countries that need money and technology for their action and other countries who need to act first. So the first is the firewall it wants to break. But the second thing that the US clearly is interested in doing by breaking this firewall is that there is no talk about money or technology for the actions that developing countries will have to take. The burden of transition has moved to us, but the money and technology will not come with it. And that, I think, is the most dangerous thing that will happen in Paris if we sign off on the deal that the US wants the world to sign off on. Right. So the question for developing countries is, are they going to be weak so that they ransom the development future of their future generations, or will they go to Paris demanding this fair play, equity, and
Yeah, can you hear me, Smita ji? Yeah, hello.
Yes, I can.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, we can hear you.
We are coming to the end of the webinar today. We have no more questions. I'm going to ask the participants who are logged in whether they would like to ask any more questions. Let me just see. No, none anymore. So we'll call it today. There is one question which has come in on the mobile. Just hold on a second, please. This is from Stephen Odoelabi, who's an African journalist. Is the US really walking its talk on fighting climate change? So what does the US seek to achieve by refusing to reduce its emissions to appreciable levels as being championed by CSE or as claimed by CSE? What should the rest of the world do to compel the US to walk the talk?
I think this is the most important question. First of all, our analysis very clearly shows that US is not acting on climate change, that all its actions are autonomous, business as usual, and that what US is hoping to do is that it will have business as usual for itself, but is talking about shifting the burden of fighting climate change to other countries, including countries in Africa and Asia. And therefore you would have seen US government doing a massive public relations exercise to first convince the world that its actions are credible, which is of course not the case as our analysis shows, but secondly also to go to different parts of the world and say that other countries should take action. Okay, so I think US is shifting the burden of transition to other countries. Now what other countries need to do is that US has we need to go back and not be defensive about ourselves. We need to be actually questioning the US on its own action. We need developing countries especially to demand credible climate action from the US, demand credible policies, and to show to the world that it is acting. At Paris, I think equity and differentiations, the cornerstone of UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, which UN wants to be, which US wants to be erased, should be brought back to the table. And then developing countries should also talk about carbon budget, how the carbon budget will be divided, and finance and technology support that they will need from countries like the US. So I think to demand their right over carbon space, as well as demand that the US and other developed countries do more for combating climate change.
Okay.
Thank you, Shubhana.
Thank you, Chandrabhushan. Is there time for one more question? We have a couple of questions coming in. One is, will your report not become grist to the anti-climate Republican mill in the US?
Very good question. I definitely want to answer that. In fact, if you look at our preface, we have actually addressed this issue because we do feel that this is going to be the disapproval that we will get from our friends in the US, saying that this is only going to play into the Republicans' hands because they want to do so little about climate change. And we finally got President Obama to speak up, and now you're even destroying that effort that he's going to make. The fact is, we would have agreed to this if they would not for two facts. One, if the US was actually doing something which was real, which was measurable, and which was effective, we would say fine. We should not ask for too much right now. They may be slow starters. They are children. They are infants in the environmental, in the climate change fight, but they will grow up. We could have given them that space to grow up, but the fact is our analysis is showing they're not growing up. They're not even born yet. Republican or Donald Trump, whatever it is, you cannot hold us to ransom saying that if we say this, Donald Trump will come to power. The fact also is, so that's my second point, that over the last 20, 30 years, as climate change negotiations have happened, we have always been told that the Democrats will be better than the Republicans, which is probably right, but the fact is Democrats are ending up with doing nothing. And in this fear of the Republicans, the world has been driven to tiptoe around the US, to do nothing, to say nothing, because Bush will be back, or now Trump will come. If Trump comes or Bush comes, the world must stand up and tell the US, we need you to do something effective. You can't hold us to ransom anymore.
Thank you so much. We are closing the webinar now. We have come to us. And a recording will be available later on for anybody who wants to take a look at it. Thank you. Thank you, participants.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Very interesting questions.
Thank you, Subhanu.